Let's try to understand what is statistics and how is statistics related to data analysis. Statistics is a science of collecting, organizing, and interpreting numerical facts, and we call these numerical facts as data points. So simply speaking, statistics is a study of data. And as a data analyst, we often have to use these different statistical techniques to analyze our data in order to find out different patterns, insights, so that businesses can make better decisions through our analysis. Now, if you're wondering about what statistical techniques do we generally use in data analysis, then don't worry, because we got you covered. If you're a beginner, then you can start by learning simple concepts like mean, median, standard deviation, correlation, and regression. Then move on to learning little bit advanced concepts like sampling distributions, probability, hypothesis testing, ANOVA, and even chi-square testing. Let's begin with understanding the most basic concept in statistics, which is the measure of central tendency. This particular concept talks about the center value of your distribution. It has three different measures: mean, median, and mode. In analysis, we generally use mean and median the most, so we'll focus more on mean and median in this video. Theoretically speaking, mean is the average value of all your observations, whereas median is the middle value of all your observations. Formulas to calculate mean and median are given on the screen. However, I would like all of you to focus more on the difference between mean and median and when should you use both of these measures in your analysis. For that, let's go ahead and consider an example to calculate mean and median and also understand the difference between both of them. Let's consider this data set where we have three columns: position, experience, and salary. This data is basically the data of employees in a company called X, where each of these employees at a different positions with these specific number of experience has this amount of salary. Now we are interested to find out the average salary of an employee in this company or the median salary of an employee in this company. We are basically trying to understand the difference between average salary and a median salary and which one should you consider in your analysis based on your requirements. So to calculate mean of the salary, I am using an Excel formula which is average of all of the data points that we have. So I'm just choosing average and I select all the data points over here and it will directly give me the average salary. So $83,556 is the average salary of an employee in this company. Now let's try to understand what is median. So median is basically the middle value. Now to calculate median, I'm using an Excel formula, which is median, and choosing again all the data points that I have in my salary column. This is giving me a median salary of $75,000. Now the basic question is that when mean and median, both of them talks about the center value of your data distribution, why are both of these values different? So to understand the basic difference between mean and median, we need to understand another concept called as outliers. Now outliers are those data points in your data which are far away from all the other data points. So these data points can be easily identified by looking at the data. Because this data set is very simple, we could just look at it and see that $150,000 is the highest salary, which is the salary of a CEO in a company. But all of the other salaries are in a different range. Let's say that all of these salaries are in a range of $60,000 to $100,000, but only one observation is $150,000. Because mean is the sum of all observations divided by the number of observations, this mean is going to be affected by the outlier in the data set. Whereas in median, we just arrange all the data points in either ascending or descending order and choose a median value. So for median, this outlier will just be considered as a data point, but the actual value of that outlier will not be considered in calculating a median. Now, if you ask me, why does even an outlier occur or how to deal with an outlier? A basic answer for that is that there could be so many reasons why an outlier can occur. Sometimes it could just be some error while typing. Let's assume that maybe this was just supposed to be $50,000 and somebody entered it as $150,000. In such situations, we could just go ahead and delete these outliers or just remove them from the data set. But in this scenario, because we're considering salaries at different levels or different positions with different number of experience, we might want to consider this $150,000. However, it would be incorrect to say that the average salary of an employee in this company is $83,556 because We know that mean is affected by this outlier, and just by having this one data point which is so higher than all the other data points, the average salary cannot be $83,556. In such situation, we could say that the median salary of an employee in this company is $75,000. Another easiest way to identify outliers in your data set is by plotting your data. Here, I can just choose all my data points here and just plot a scatter plot or any type of plot, and can see that all the other data points are in a specific range, whereas this one particular data point is far away from all the data points. With this example, we clearly understood that just by knowing the measure of center could be misleading, and we want to understand the spread of data or the variability in the data, which talks about how your data is distributed across. And to understand the measure of spread, we are going to consider another important concept called as quartiles. Now, quartiles generally divide your entire data into different percentiles, and it is basically a combination of both your measure of center and measure of spread. So to see how quartiles can be calculated, I've considered this entire salary column into a new sheet and arranged them in ascending order. After arranging all the data points into ascending order, I am considering the middle value to be my median, which is $75,000. And if you can see, when we also calculated median here, we've seen that the median is $75,000. And even here, after arranging all of them into ascending order, the middle value is going to be median. Now, because my median is dividing my entire data into two equal halves, I will consider median to be a 50th percentile, and all the observations which are below my median are called to be in the lower quartile. And similarly, all the observations which are above my median are to be called in upper quartile. Now that we have calculated our measure of center, let's see how to calculate the measure of spread. And to do that, I am going to calculate another median with all the observations which are below my actual median. So just with four observations, I'm going to find the median among only these observations. And so my median is going to be somewhere between $65,000 and $70,000. So my median among all these four observations is going to be $67,500. And I'll consider this $67,500 to be Q1. Or this could also be called as the 25th percentile. So similarly, on my upper quartile, I'm going to again calculate median with all these four observations, and my median is going to be somewhere between $85,000 and $95,000. So my new median for all the values within upper quartile is going to be $90,000. So this $90,000 will be my Q3. Or this will also be the 75th percentile. Now, if you can see, I have my lowest observation, which is the minimum data point, and that is considered to be my minimum value in my entire data set. Then Q1 or 25th percentile is the median of the observations within the lower quartile range. Then I have median, which is the 50th percentile, and I'm just taking the median over here. And again, my $90,000 is Q3 or the 75th percentile, which is the median of the observations above my actual median. So this is Q3, and $150,000 is the maximum data point. So these five values, minimum value, Q1, median, Q3, and maximum, all these five set of observations together make five number summary. So five number summary is just a set of observations which includes the minimum data point Q1 or the 25th percentile, median or the 50th percentile, Q3 or the 75th percentile, and the maximum value. Now, this five number summary can also be represented by using a box plot, which I can just plot right now by selecting all of my data points, and I just go to insert, choose a histogram, and within histogram I can choose a box and whisker plot. Now, if you can see, this is the box plot which will represent the five number summary. Within this box plot, how to interpret it is that the line you see over here is called the minimum value. So the minimum value in my observation is 60,000. So that 60,000 is represented over here in the box plot. Then the first line you see here, this is the Q1 or the 25th percentile. Then the center line is the median or the 50th percentile. And this line is the Q3 or 75th percentile. And this is the maximum value of my data. Now, the minimum value and the maximum value actually do not describe anything about the spread of the data. The spread of the data can be described by the difference in Q1 and Q3. All the data points which are lying between your Q1 and Q3, they tell us how the data is actually spread across. So there is another concept called as interquartile range, which tells us how our data is actually spread or distributed across. So this interquartile range or IQR is a formula which is our Q3 minus Q1. Q3 is the third quartile and Q1 is the first quartile, which is represented by this point and this line within your box plot. So this difference gives you the interquartile range. Now, what is the advantage of knowing interquartile range? That is because you will understand if your data is skewed or not, which tells you what all data points are lying towards your minimum point and towards your maximum point. The five number summary and interquartile range can also be used to find out a potential outlier in your data point, and that is calculated by using another rule called 1.5 into IQR range. I will show all of that clearly, but let's first try to calculate the interquartile range or IQR, which is our Q3 minus Q1. So my Q3 in this example is $90,000. So I'm taking my Q3 minus my Q1, which is $67,500. I'm taking that as my Q1. So the solution is $22,500, which is my IQR or my interquartile range. Now that I have my IQR, which is $22,500, let's try to see if we have any outliers in our data points. And to do that, I'm going to use another rule called as 1.5 times of my IQR value. So this value, when I calculate it, that is equals to 1.5 times my IQR, which is 22,500. So my new value is 33,750, and using this value, I'm going to find out if there are any outliers in the data or not. So theoretically speaking, any data point which lies below 1.5 into IQR times from my first quartile will be considered an outlier. And on the above, we'll consider the same rule, but this is above third quartile. So to calculate and see that, I'm going to just take my Q1, which is 67,500, minus the 1.5 times IQR value, which is $33,750. So this is my first range. That means any data point below 33,750 could be considered as an outlier. And on the other hand, we'll take our Q3 value, which is $90,000, plus the 1.5 times of IQR value, which is $33,750. So this is $123,750. So any data points which is below $33,750 and above $123,750, those data points can be considered as outliers. And in our example, we could see that the minimum data point is just $60,000. So there is nothing which is below $60,000, which means there is nothing that is below $33,750. So there are no outliers on the lower side. Whereas when we check on the upper hand, we could see that we have our highest value to be $150,000, which is greater than $123,750. That means we have one outlier, which is $150,000. And this outlier will also be represented like this in your box plot. So this is a suspected outlier in our data. Now we have understood how five number summary and IQR range can help us not just understand the spread of data, but also how we can identify potential outliers in our data. Quartiles and five-number summary is not the most commonly used measure of spread or measure of variability. We generally use standard deviation the most, which we will cover in the upcoming video. However, this video was made for all of you to get familiarized with the concepts of mean, median, and how outliers can completely change your analysis. By knowing these concepts of mean, median, and measure of spread, you can answer important business questions like the average sales of a company in the previous quarter. And the measure of spread will actually give you a complete understanding of your data set. If you like this content, please do like, share, and subscribe to our YouTube channel.